The first thing I want to say is my objective and your objective. Both of our objective is same. You are here to pass the case study exam. You are here to pass the exam in the first attempt only. And I am there to achieve that objective. I am helping you to pass the exam. Your success is my success. My success is your success. If you pass the exam, you will be going to strategic level. You will be giving the next exam. You will be completing SEMA. You will be able to get growth in life. The benefit to you is less. The benefit to me is more. If I will be able to make pass all the students, say 100% result, I will be getting reward from SEMA Institute. Maybe ignore that. I will be getting more and more students. More and more students will be joining my classes. You are satisfied. You will be recommending others. And whether you recommend or not, automatically I will be getting benefit. Your benefit on a scale of 1 to 10, maybe 2 or 3. But my benefit on a scale of 1 to 10 is 100. It is not measurable in scale. So we are on the same page that your objective is to pass the exam and my objective is to make you pass the exam. So our mentality, thinking process should be same. We should be on the same page in every respect so that we will be able to pass this exam in the first attempt. The SEMA case study exams are happening since 2015. So it's the, you can say, seventh year that the case study exam is happening. And in 2015, 16, 17, 18 and 19, 5 years, you can say that the case study exam was old syllabus. Then from 20 and then this 2021, it's a new syllabus. But as far as case study exam is concerned, the changes from the old syllabus to the new syllabus is very, very marginal. Marginal in the sense, in the old case study exam, when they used to give the question paper, they don't mention in front of the questions what is the percentage of marks allocated to that portion. Suppose in exam, I will be showing you the question paper. Nowadays, they are saying that from 2020 exams, suppose there is a question of 25 marks and it includes three parts, A, B, C. Then suppose part A is 40%, part B is 30%, part C is 30%, which they are now writing in front of the question the percentage of marks allocation. In 2019 exams, up till 2019, in case study, it was not mentioned. The A, B, C individual marking portion was not known to the student. But now it is known. It's good only that we come to know that this question is of more marks. I should be writing more. I should be more detailed in that. The other question is less marks. That is good for us. In 2019 syllabus, the 15 syllabus, 2015 syllabus. Each pre-seen question releasing, I will say that it's not a question. Because if they will release the question, then so it's a cakewalk. It's not a question. Let me say everything, you will understand. Let me complete everything. I am saying that in the old exam, that is in 2015 syllabus, they were not specifically saying for the case study, what are the major areas of the syllabus which are relevant for the case study. But in 2019 syllabus, that is 2021 and further 3 years exam, they have categorized that in the case study exam, what are the areas which are going to be tested, which are said as core areas, core area A, B, C, D, E, 5 areas are there. I will not say that there is a major difference from old and new, because in the core areas, they have actually written everything. Earlier, they were not writing core area A, B, C, D, E. It was entire syllabus of, you can say, E to P to F to. Now they are mentioning the core area A, B, C, D, E, 5 areas, and which is actually virtually covering the most of the syllabus portion of E to P to F to. Enterprise pillar, performance pillar and financial pillar. You can say that it is more structured now, that what are the areas we need to study, on what areas the questions will be asked. Earlier, it was open-ended. It was not said as core areas. But now the core areas are defined by the institute. Those are the two changes from old to new. As far as syllabus is concerned, in 2015 syllabus, the IT digital part was less. In 2019 syllabus, the IT digital part is more relevant. But believe me, when I taught the case studies for 15, 16, 17, 18, 19 for 5 years, maybe there are something not written in the book, in Kaplan or study text, but in the case study, they ask those things. Specifically in strategic level case study also. And in 2019 syllabus, when they printed the new materials, those things were technically included in the write-up of the books, but they were already asked in the exam as far as case study exam is concerned. So I can say that if you go with the syllabus area, that the syllabus which is 2019 new syllabus as compared to 15, the IT incorporation is there in the entire CIMA curriculum. In E1 also, in E2 also, in P1, P2 also, in strategic level E3 also, P3 also. The finance pillar is more or less same. It's just haphazard here and where. Something they have transferred from F2 to F1, something taken from F3 to F2, like that. More or less is same. But the E pillar mainly, the IT portions, they have increased the write-up in the entire CIMA curriculum. Because the business cannot function without IT. You say information technology, you say digital age, you say social media, whatever language you want to say, but they have included in E1, E2, E3, all the enterprise pillar, more and more detail relating to IT areas. These are the major changes from 2015 to 19. But the setting of the questions, earlier in 2015 syllabus for management case study, the setting of the questions for 2019 case study, that is 2021 exam, are same. That has not changed. So major point of difference is what? Percentage of marks allocation for different questions. Then core areas are more straight away defined. More inclusion of IT. More syllabus guidance on IT as compared to 2015 syllabus. Otherwise, there is no difference in the case study exam as compared to 2015 syllabus or 19 syllabus. There is one major change which is not related with the syllabus. In 2015, 16, 17, 18 and 19, 5 years, the direct entry in the gateway exam, which I will say that in our class, except Karthik, everybody is a gateway student. That means all the students, those who are going to attend the classes, they all are a direct entry to CIMA in management case study exam. All have not given any single paper. Earlier in 2019, up till 2019, in the class in management case study, I will say that around 40 to 50% of the student as a normal CIMA student, they were doing the CIMA from the beginning. But nowadays, the CIMA students are more and more from the exemption route. It's good that we are not required to give the exam. We got the exemption. Karthik can understand the pain of giving all those exams. Those who have not given, they cannot understand the pain. But then the question is that, why they are allowing straight away for giving the case study exam? Is this attracting the students to join CIMA? Somebody can say that, yes. But according to me, that is not the case. According to me, if I will say logically why they are allowing the exemption route, the reason is that whatever we study in any book, whatever we have studied in our life, I have studied so many books and all that. While teaching, I will be saying so many technical things. But when we work in any organization, whatever the technical areas written in the book, because you all are working, the usage of your technical knowledge is maximum 10 to 20%. Whatever is written in any book, in our practical working, the usage of technical knowledge is 10 to 20%. We are not, while working in any organization, you all are working 5, 7, 10 years, different types of experience in our class. When you are working regularly, for working, whether in accounts, whether in finance or anything, you are not opening books. You are not opening. You are doing the work with your knowledge, with your practicality. The SEMA Institute is saying that for work, for efficient working, for having better communication, for helping the board members, the technical knowledge is not required in that way that we study in the books. And if the students are getting exemptions, then definitely most of the technical study they have done in any other curriculum, maybe in BCom or anywhere. They are not focusing on technical, but not zero. That without technical, you can pass this exam. No, I'm not saying zero, but one by one line, mugging up the line by line, paragraph by paragraph is not going to help. They are saying that it's more on application. Whatever you have studied in your technical material, either in SEMA or anywhere, it's an exam which is based on practical knowledge. That is, when you are working anywhere in the organization at a particular level, then at your level, whatever the problems and issues are there in the organization, you need to bring or you need to solve those problems in the organization. You need to give a solution to the organization. You need to become a problem solver, which we are actually doing in our practical world day-to-day life. So the case study exam is bent or analyzed on that perspective. So technical knowledge, basic understanding is required. We can't ignore that. But then once somebody will have the good technical knowledge, that does not mean that the student can pass the case study exam. It's more application of that knowledge. It's not involving calculator. The case study exam does not require generally in exam. If you take the, you are allowed to take calculator in exam, but the calculator generally not used in the exam because it's explanation of the calculation already given to you, either in the pre-seen, either in the unseen, in the exam, whatever. Generally, in my last 7 years experience of teaching case study, I think in at least, I mean to say maximum 1 or 2 paper, a student may have used some calculator. But otherwise, generally the students are not using any calculator in exam. So it's not an exam based on calculation. It's an exam based on interpretation, analysis, understanding, communicating, helping the board members or senior managers in the organization. That the job of the, you can say, management accounting. And they are testing that knowledge in a very high level. In place of technicality, they are testing the practical knowledge in the exam. Application of that knowledge, whatever you studied in the books, that they require. So I will say that any student, whether it's Karthik, studied E2, P2, F2. He has not studied E2, P2, F2 yesterday. Maybe he has studied E2, P2, F2 in 2 years. He also cannot remember whatever he studied in E2 or P2 or F2 individually in a paragraph or in a chapter. Even I'm questioning Karthik, even you ask me, I cannot remember all the broader headings and everything, whatever is written in any material. No problem. I don't want in the SEMA case study exam to replicate whatever I studied in the books. I need to have understanding of that. And whether in the given situation that is relevant or not, that I need to present in the exam. Not that the bookish language will be helpful. They are not going to be written in the exam answer. Neither the institute is writing, neither they are expecting the student can write or should be writing to getting the pass mark. So that's not the question. So it's more of a practical application as compared to bookish study, which makes the SEMA a different type of exam as compared to any other exam, which is the beauty of the SEMA course. It's not a question of good or bad, but you can see that there is no fixed answer for any question. Even though suppose we are discussing in the class relating to a question, a perfect solution and all that, there is no perfect solution possible. Everybody has his own style, own understanding, own piece of thought that need to be presented in the answer. Your answer may be different than mine. Anybody has written a different answer. Everybody will be getting the marks if they are actually correct as per the requirement of the question. You can say they are correct as per the situation which is there in the question and as per the situation, your judgment, your write-up, your understanding is logical. Maybe there are other thought possible, but you have a particular thought, I have a different thought, somebody has a different thought, and all are logical in that given situation, the student will be getting the marks. Because it's not a question and answer format. Questions will be there. We have to write the answer. But the answers, there is no fixed style or fixed thing which we can write in the answer. For every question, there can be 7-8 types of answers possible. Different types of solutions possible. There is no fixed answer. For that reason, whenever they publish the past exam answers, they categorically say that this is not the only answer. They are saying that they are not going to receive challenge. If somebody will challenge SEMA Institute, you have written this why. This would be the answer. They have written categorically. They are not saying that the answer written by the institute as a suggested answer, the student can write those answers. Even that answer, I cannot write. Because that is not written, that is not given to the student that they can replicate those answers. When we read the suggested answers, model answers, then we need to understand that how we need to build a correct answer, a proper answer. Maybe they have written 10 things, you can write 3-4 things in the exam. You will be easily able to get through the exam. Because it's not the first time 2021 that the student will be giving the case study exam. They are giving for many years and the students are passing on that basis only. It's not that anybody is using a rocket science to pass the exam. But that is a problem also. That if there is a question in which you need to prepare the balance sheet tally, the adjustments are correct, you will get the marks. This is not balance sheet, PL account preparation, or this is not calculation of cash flow from a project. The cash flows are given, the financials are given. You need to interpret, you need to analyze where the financials are good, where they are bad, what improvements are required that way. So your analysis, my analysis need not necessarily be seen. You have a different perspective, I have a different perspective, but I am logical, you are also logical, we both will be getting marks. So never in our entire study pattern of coming days that for giving the exam, we need to mug up anything, never. Because if you start mugging up, the problem will be there in writing a good answer. You cannot mug up anything because there is no fixed answer for any question. You need to open up your brain. You need to understand that this answer should be written like this and I should be communicating like this. This would be my writing style. You will be automatically getting the marks. One thing I can say, whatever is asked in the question, I will be showing you how they are asking question. Whatever is asked in the question, and if I am writing as per the requirement of the question, logical answer, whether I am technically perfect or not, but I am explaining the question's requirement in the logical way, I will be 100% getting very good marks. The question of passing or failing does not arise. The problems with the students, if you read the marking guidelines or the examiner's feedback, in every paper, in every question, the examiner is saying only one thing. The student is writing something else which is asked in the question. And if the student is writing something else which is not asked in the question, marks is zero. It is not starting at all. If the student is understanding the requirement and they are writing the answer as per the requirement, the student cannot fail. The students are failing in the exam only because of one reason. They are not understanding the requirement. They are very fast. They are not interpreting the question properly. So they are writing whatever is not asked in the question, whatever is not relevant with the question. So ultimately, they are not awarded any marks. That's the prime important thing, that while writing the answer, exactly what they are asking. Maybe for the time being, you will think that, sir, what is the issue in that? When I will be teaching, not in the today's class, in many classes, then you will realize that this is the base, my most important issue, understanding the requirement. Sometime the student will say that, sir, I'm not understanding why you are saying this, why you are right, why this will be the answer. Then I will read the question 2-3 times in front of you. Then the same student will say, yes, it is asking that. I was not understanding. So I was in the wrong direction. That's the major issue with the students. And the major issue another is that the E2 pillar, even though suppose there are leadership theories written in the book, there are management theories written in the book, there are so many types of economist theories written in the book. If you ask me, leadership theories, there are 2-3 economist leadership theories written in E2 material. Maybe I have read that at least 10-12 times up till now, at least. Still, if you ask me today, I don't remember that exactly what each taught, what each explained as per the leadership theories. But I know what is the meaning of a leader. I understand who can be said as a leader. I can say that in Reliance, Ambani can be treated as a leader. In Kolkata, Mamata Banerjee can be treated as a leader. I can say that Mr. Modi can be treated as a leader. Why they are treated as a leader? You think logically, practically, whatever any book will write. If you start thinking in a practical sense, you don't have to read any book for leadership theories. And while writing the answers in the exam, who said that whatever is written in the Kaplan or BPP or any study material about leadership, I need to write the same language, comma, full stop. I am not interested also, and I am not interested in mugging up. I have my own understanding about leadership. I can write that. So the E2 portions, which are, you can say, base of your answers in the exam, they are very open-ended. They are very practical. Even though the student at the beginning think that the E2 is very difficult, but when you start writing answers, you will realize in, you can say, next session only that E2 is very easy to handle. P2, some of the areas are like E2, open-ended. But P2, some of the areas are technical. Suppose the question is about value chain analysis. Now, if somebody don't know anything about value chain, how he will write the answer? Suppose the question is about total quality management. Suppose the question is about ABC. Suppose the question is about some special type of risk and uncertainty. If I don't know, I cannot write anything. And the F2, the financial pillar, group accounting, deferred tax, asset treatment, source of funding, I think entire F2 portion is very technical. The student face problem in writing the answers for F2 pillar as far as management case studies concerned and some of the part of the P2 pillar which are technical. Because in that part, if you don't have some basic knowledge, you cannot write anything logical. And if in entire question paper, suppose your one of the question answer is very bad, there will be 4 questions. I will be coming with the set of paper, but there will be 4 questions. And suppose your 3 answers are very good, but the 1 question answer is not good, or I will say very bad. And in that question, they have actually tested the F2 pillar. Even though your 3 questions answers is very good, but still the student will not be passing the exam. Because in the financial pillar, the student knowledge is poor. It's below average. The student will not be declared as a pass. So for that reason, your performance in any part of the question cannot be very poor. It should be at least average or above than average, but it will be not, it should not be acceptable that any part of the answer in the entire paper can be poor. That is not allowed. So the major focus by you, by me and everybody is to focus on those technical portions more and more in the class, again and again discussion, so that at least maybe by my discussing the things again and again, reading on your own and again, you will be able to conversant yourself with those technical parts in coming 50 days. Because exam is on 19th May, 19th, 28th, 21st, 3 days. I think either 19th, 20th, 21 or 20th, 21, 22. I don't remember. We take say around 50 days are left. In those 50 days, the focus is to cover those technical portions properly. How? What is the way by which we can complete those technical portion, the F2 portion and some portions of P2 which are technical. When all of you joined, on the first day when you joined, I have given you the YouTube separate videos, which does not require any software. In YouTube, I have uploaded thousands of videos. You cannot refer every video, not required also. But whatever is more important, with the technical perspective, you will find that in my video list, the 80% of the videos are related with F2 and the technical part of P2. Relating to E2, the videos are very less. You can say a videos on earnings per share, a videos on share based payment, a videos on consolidation group accounting, the concept, a videos on ratio analysis, a videos on relating to P2 portion. Most of the videos I have taken from YouTube, which is freely available. But for a student, it will be difficult to find out which one is relevant. I first of all share with all of you those videos only, which does not require any software, anything. You just need to go through with those videos and make your technical knowledge from 0 to a scale of 10 or 20. Suppose 0 to 100. I want that by looking at the videos and all that, you will take to yourself not 100, but at least 20 to 30. From where I can take you to 100. But if you are staying at 0, it will be difficult to take you 100 from 0. For that reason, whether you join today, whether you join 10 days back, whether you join 20 days back, whether you join 2 months back, first of all, you all have been given the free video list of YouTube. And I said categorically to all of you in the message, voice message, that please first of all complete all the free videos of YouTube. Then you will be doing the videos which is through the software. I always said, still the same I am saying. If somebody has not started studying, it's not a problem because 50 days are enough to prepare. But then if you don't start now also, and we will think that just on the basis of pre-seen material we study, we cannot pass. Because the F2 portion is very technical. And if my technical knowledge is not coming to a level, I will not be able to write any answer in the F2 exam, in the F2 portion. And I cannot pass the exam without having technical knowledge of F2. For that reason, your duty, whether you have not done in the past, that's immaterial. Your duty in coming 10 to 15 days, with a folded hand, I am requesting, please complete the YouTube videos which has been given to you. The all videos are separate chapter. One is on group accounting, one is on share-based payment, one is on EPS, like lease accounting, different. They are separate videos. They all are standalone. When you refer those videos, your basic knowledge relating to F2 and P2 will be coming from 0 to 20, 30, 40, whatever level I require. So if anybody has not done that or have not done that properly, the first important thing is to make your technical knowledge taking to the next level. When you will be there already at some level, then when I will be अभी दिखाते हैं आपको. ऐसा कोई नहीं है जिसको मैंने नहीं दिया. प्रूफ. व्हाट इज योर मेल आईडी? व्हाट इज योर मेल आईडी आंचल? गीत आंचल. ओके. ये भी एक तो प्रॉब्लम है. मे बी आई हैव नॉट शेयर्ड विथ यू आई हैव, बट 99% आई मस्ट हैव शेयर्ड. गीत आंचल. ओके. सीमा कोर्स हाईलाइट रिमाइंडर लास्ट क्लास. You are correct, I have not given to you. Sorry. You are correct. But generally, the way I have checked your email ID, everybody, suppose you will say that, sir, I have not received the mail. You can type in your search mailbox, classes, ID, classes, @, you will get all the links, all the mails which we have communicated ever in the past. So I have not shared with you live class instruction, SCS, reminder, live class, May August. SEMA course highlight, payment confirmation. You have not given. Achha, one second. Theek hai. I will give just now only. But I mean to say that everybody need to complete those videos. Because they will be covering most of the portions of technical areas. So that your knowledge will be reaching to such level that I am in a position to explain you the concepts in much detail. That's the first requirement from all of you. The videos from YouTube, then the videos from the software. The videos from the software will be basically, you can say, November 2020 classes. They will help you to gear up that how the questions will be asked, how the answer will be written. With the discussion, you will be able to make up your mind. You will be able to prepare yourself better. I always say that the student need to have go through with some recordings before starting the live classes. Say around 25-30 hours of recording. Kam se kam. If they go, I will say that around 40 hours because YouTube videos is around 20 hours. Then the November case study is around 20-25 hours. So around 40-45 hours recording, the students would complete. If somebody has not done anything, joined today, recently joined, not started, whatever may be the case. But you have to take a point that you need to complete by 10th of April. You can't delay beyond that. All the YouTube videos and the software related videos, you all need to complete by 10th of April in coming 10 days. If you have done very well, if you have not done, then complete that. One more thing in the chat, when you all are chatting, in the chat box, there is written to below. Beside to, there is a drop down arrow. Click the drop down arrow, select everyone and then chat in the class. So that whatever you are chatting, other can see. Otherwise, if you are chatting directly to me, then others are not able to see. So we are on a different page. If we want to be everybody on the same page, we need to chat to everyone. No personal chatting to anybody. Just chat to everyone. No problem. No issue. So what I mean to say that, complete those videos if you want to pass the exam. Because on the basis of pre-seen material, just study, we cannot pass. Our technical knowledge, we need to improve. Maybe we got the exemptions, it's a good thing. But some technical knowledge we need to cover up. Now you can see that if I will suppose this is a 2020 exam, February 2020. This is the answer for the February 2020, one of the variant. And this is the question. Hypothetically, I am taking any one variant and the answers for that variant. And the examiner's marking guidelines also, variant 1. Now, we have not studied this pre-seen material. And I am not going into that detail also for this. Because my objective is not that to teach you the old pre-seen, not required. But as a basic understanding, the pre-seen material for May and August exam will be releasing tomorrow. Tomorrow, the institute is releasing for management case study, May and August exam, the pre-seen material, 1st April 2021. And the exam for May is on 19th or 28th of the May. So you can say that it's 49 days before the exam, they are going to release the pre-seen material. The pre-seen material is not a set of questions. The pre-seen material is what? Suppose I will go in any pre-seen material of the past term. The pre-seen material for November 2020. The pre-seen material for November 2020. Pre-seen material. One second. Not an issue. Suppose for this is February 2020 pre-seen material. When the institute will release pre-seen material tomorrow, then they will release the pre-seen material like this only. It's a 31 page material. Around 25 to 30 pages the material is there. It is about a particular company. The name of the company is Travel. The Travel is a quoted company that creates and sells music. The company is selling music online, in cassettes, in DVDs, in vinyl, different types of music they are selling. Now, obviously, this case study material is prepared based on the practical companies in the market. But they are using an hypothetical name, mixing 2-3 companies from the market. A research has been done by the SEMA Institute, and then this material is prepared. So this Travel Record company is a company which is selling music. And in this company, we as an examinee is a developed country where the company is situated. Who are we? You are the finance manager of this company. In every case study exam of management level, we are the finance manager of the company. We are going to report to senior finance manager. Our boss is senior finance manager. And the senior finance manager job is finance director. You can say other directors also. So we are the finance manager of the company. And our primary responsibility associated with management accounting, you report to the senior finance manager. He reports directly to finance director. The comma full stop, every case study, the same paragraph is written. That who are you, whom you will report, and then what is the ultimate report going on? What is your job? When the pre-seen material tomorrow will be released for May exam, that will be writing the same language. You can check there. So in this material, they have written about first page, about the company, about their business, your responsibility. Then in the second page, they are talking about the entire industry, music industry, how the industry developed, what is the history of the industry, how the people started selling music, how the people buying the music and all that. They are writing 2-3 pages about that. Then they are saying that how the music business money is being done, how the musics are developed, how they are sold to the consumers, what is the pattern, what are the methodology by which the business happens, by which the business is done. Then they are talking about some graphical presentation also, the global music sale or whatever different types of sale is there, the graphical pie chart and all that. Then they will be started telling about the particular company, that is the Travel company, how they are doing their business, since when they are established, who are their management, where they are established, what is, whether their business is country specific or it's a multinational company, how the business is growing, what is the responsibility of the board of directors, who are the directors, who are the executive directors, non-executive directors, what are the challenges the business is facing. They are talking about the industry, the company's mission, vision, goals, objectives. Then the company's financial statement. The board structure, the financial statement, PL account, balance sheet, notes to accounts, any competitor company, their details, their financials, then some newspaper article, some magazine article about the industry, about the particular company. Then maybe sometimes they give the taxation structure also. That is what is not in every case study, that in the country where we are located, what is the tax structure? It is not a question. It's not a set of questions which they are going to ask in the exam. There is no question here. It is just saying you that suppose I want to work in this company. Whatever will be the industry tomorrow, we will come to know. Today we don't know because it will be releasing tomorrow. But the same story will be there about a different industry. Never in last 7 years any industry is repeated. Every time there is a new industry. And this pre-seen material is saying what? Pre-seen. That is 45-50 days before the exam, the material will be given to the student. It will be released for the students. And suppose on 19th of May, I have an interview in this company for the post of finance manager. You think in that way, you got a money offer. You applied there. You got an offer from this company that on 1st April, congratulations Prakash Saraf, you are appointed or you are called for an interview on 19th of May at this place and all that. Please come with all your documents and CVs and all that for the interview. Now, whether the interview will be what type of interview, one by one, in a group interview, technical or whatever, the interview is there. And you need to prepare for the interview. Whenever in practical life, we are going for an interview in any organization, what we normally do? We go into the website of the company. Every company has a website. We need to know the company's product, their business, the mission, vision, their board of directors, their business is spread out and all that. We come to know about the company. Then we do some research that in this company, what are the things important? And then we go for the interview. Now the interviewer can ask you any question. Maybe relating to accounts, finance, marketing, HR, anything. What is a management accountant job? Managing everything. Not only relating to accounts, everything. You are said as management accountant because you have the management capability. And if whatever is asked in the interview, you can answer properly. You can't prepare for the interview what question they will ask. Nobody can prepare. There can be millions of questions possible. But if you are well prepared, you are on the day of the interview giving the correct answer to the questions, you will be selected. Or you can say that you are already working in the company, not an interview. You are already working in the company as a finance manager. Not that you are Prakash Saraf giving the exam. You are Karthik giving the exam. Don't think in that line. It's not an exam. You are already the finance manager of the company. You know everything about the company, what they are doing because you are working in the company for a long time. And the company is facing problems, issues, opportunities in different areas. Launching of a new product, going into a new market, some financial adjustments, some internal control issues, some risk, anything. There cannot be any limit what they can ask. But you as a finance manager need to help the company, the board members, colleagues or juniors or anybody that the problem can be solved in the best possible way. You need to have for that purpose a leadership quality because a finance manager is not a normal person. He is above the operational level, finance manager, controlling the operations staff, at the same time reporting to the board member, senior finance manager and everybody. So you are getting instructions, you are getting the suggestions, you are getting the call from the board members, from the senior finance manager. Those persons are making long-term strategies. The long-term strategies means for 5 years, 10 years, what should be done by the company. They are communicating you as a finance manager. Now you need to implement them. You need to break down the strategy into small parts. That if I want to achieve something after 4 years, what I should be doing for coming 6 months? How it can be done? How cost can be controlled? How the financial statement will be affected if this decision is taken? So this is what? This is case study exam. You can't say that if we will be studying, suppose on the basis of the pre-seen material which will be released tomorrow, if we study for 2 years, then also the questions will not be covered. There can be millions of questions possible based on this material. So a pre-seen material is just giving you a background. This is the industry. This is the detail about the industry. In that industry, this is a hypothetical company. The detail of the company, their financials, their board, their business, their culture, and then some financial information, and then some newspaper clips and magazine article that they are giving in the pre-seen. And then on the day of exam, on the basis of this pre-seen material, they are preparing 5 to 6 variants. Earlier they were preparing 5, now they have started 6 variants. 6 variants means 6 types of question paper. Normally 5, but I have seen that in the last term, in the November case study, in a strategic case study, they have made 6 types of papers. 6 question paper based on the same pre-seen material. So now it's not a rule that on the basis of pre-seen 5 papers, 6, 7, whatever. The exams will be 3 days. That is 19, 20, 21 or 20, 21, 22, whatever. You can select any one day. Suppose I am giving exam on 19th. Sunil is also giving exam on 19th. On 20th, the other 2-3 students are giving exam. On 21st, somebody is giving. But we are not the only student giving exam. In the whole world, the management case study is being given around 1,000, 2,000 students. I don't know, whatever is the number. I mean to say that all those students will be giving exam those 3 days. If there are 5 sets of question papers, 5 variants, the sets of question papers are variant 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 like that. So if I am giving exam and Sunil is giving exam on 19th, we both can get any variant. Maybe variant 1, maybe variant 2, maybe variant 3, maybe variant 4, maybe variant 5. And in every question paper, this is the answer, I think. One second. The question paper. This is variant 1 question paper. This is variant 1 question paper. When you will open in the exam, you can give exam in exam center. If the corona is not creating a problem. But if the corona is creating a problem, you will be giving exam by sitting in home. So there is no question of cancellation of exam. What will happen for May exam? It's very difficult to say. Because earlier the cases were increasing in Mumbai and all that. Now in Kolkata also we realize that in the building, nearby building, the cases are increasing. Now we don't know whether it will be a center-based exam. We just need to understand it's a computer-based exam. Whether you are giving exam in the exam center, then also on a screen. Whether it's an exam sitting in home, remote-based exam, then also on a screen. It's a computer-based exam. So anywhere the exam will be there, this is the question paper. This is February 2020 question paper. The first section, 45 marks. There are 2 tasks, 50-50%. The second set, again 45 marks, 2 tasks. Everywhere 2 tasks each, 45 marks each. Then in the, you can say the first scenario they have given. This is the first scenario. When you will be in the exam hall, then let me make it 100%. When you will be in the exam hall and you reach to this screen, the time started counting. It was 45 minutes. Once you are on this screen, the 1 second, 2 seconds are getting reduced. That means you will be reading this. You will be clicking the reference material. You will be reading that. The pre-seen material tab is there. Whatever pre-seen they will release tomorrow, that pre-seen in the exam hall, anytime you can open, because that pre-seen tab is there. If you forget anything from the pre-seen, you want to refer in the exam, that is given to every student. And relating to this, there is a reference material. The reference material here is not clickable, but in exam it is clickable. It is given in the next page, the reference material. That is prepared by NRE, Director of Marketing and Business Development. They are giving some story, some information, some situation. And relating to this situation, relating to this reference material, they have asked 2 questions. 50% part A, 50% part B. And then when you are moving forward, the answer sheet is there where you can type your answer. It's like Word file only, but all the Word file, normal Word window features is not there. Just the basic features are there. The back, forward, or I can say bold, italics, underline. Then you can see adjustments. All these things are there. I will say that in exam, you don't have to all use all these things. Just focus on writing a proper answer as per the requirement. Now suppose, for the this is the question paper only, variant 1. For this question paper, they have written this answer. I have not read the question. The reason being that we cannot waste our time on reading the question which came in February 2020, which was the material totally different. But before reading the answer, what they are writing? These answers have been provided by Seema for information purposes only. The answers created are indicative of a response that could be given by a good candidate. The answers created are indicative of a response that could be given by a good candidate. They are not to be considered exhaustive. That is, it is not that whatever is written in the answer, I need to write that only. You can have a different view. You can have a different point you can write, because it is not the exhaustive answer. And other appropriate relevant responses would receive credit. What is not in the suggested answer, if you have a different understanding and your understanding is logical, you are writing that in the exam, they will give you marks. It's not the only answer. Seema will not accept challenges to these answers on the basis of academic judgment. If suppose I am a very knowledgeable person, I read the question paper, then I am reading the answer, and I am thinking that Seema Institute is not correct, and I am raising a question on the Seema Institute that I am not liking this answer, this is, they are saying that they will not accept any challenge. Whatever is written, it's just a suggested answer. You can have a different opinion. There is no problem. I am just reading one or two paragraphs, not for the sake of what we will write, just for an important aspect, that how to write the answer. Suppose the question is relating to value chain. Now, if the student don't know anything relating to value chain, what he will write, you can understand. He will be getting big laddus because he don't know anything relating to value chain. They are writing in one paragraph, first paragraph. At present, the primary activities in the value chain associated with the back catalog are limited and very straightforward. The digital sales require little more than limited marketing to support their popularity and a limited number of infrastructure, primarily in terms of processing receipts from sales and royalties and payment of royalties to artists. Sales on CD involve a physical product, but that is not much more complicated because the manufacture of CD is outsourced to a third party. And so the only additional activities are the logistics associated with procurement and the manufacturing and the logistics associated with managing the resulting inventory. The first paragraph is saying that, I don't know about the question, but whatever is the question, they are saying that relating to that, the value chain is not so important. Relating to that, I don't know what is the situation they have given. They are saying that whatever presently we are selling in CD, DVDs and all that, the value chain is already very less. If we are selling music through website online, then also the value chain is very less. The new things in which we are going, the value chain is not so much involved. The most immediate concern in terms of Treble's primary activities is the need to market the new range of vinyl recordings. The company cannot take it for granted that the continuing popularity of digital copies will translate the sales of vinyl. In the first instance, Treble will have to invest in market research with a view to identify the target market and the albums that are likely to prove popular in this format. The company will also have to develop a marketing strategy that promotes the vinyl format without undermining the digital recordings that will continue to be company's primary source of revenue. What they are saying that in the second paragraph, suppose maybe there is a question, the scenario is relating to development of vinyl and selling of vinyl. Vinyl means you must have seen a old videos that the tape recorder button is there and then it go round and round and then we will be able to hear. Those who are music lover, they are generally purchasing vinyl and all that because the quality of the music is very good. Even I will say that nowadays in the mobile phone and smart TVs, the quality is also good. But then those who are music lovers, you will go in their houses, they will have the big round this thing, then the vinyl where you can put the vinyl and then it will be running. And the vinyl take huge space. Even in big music shop, you will be able to find the vinyl. Maybe they are saying that the company want to sell the vinyl. So for selling the vinyl, what value chain they require? Value chain means what? For making and selling the vinyl, we need to produce vinyl. We need to keep the inventory of vinyl. We need to do the marketing of vinyl. We need to sell to the customers. Then there will be any problem with the customer. We need to deal with those issues. For those activities, we require support of IT. We require support of HR. We require support of human resource. All these things we require. That is technically called value chain. So in the first thing, they are saying that the value chain is not a big deal here. But in the second paragraph, they are saying that relating to vinyl, what are the areas where we need to concentrate on value chain? The vinyl recording will also impose a significant strain on travel logistics, both inbound and outbound. Inbound means for manufacturing vinyl, you need to purchase materials and all that. So inbound logistics relating with that. Outbound means when the vinyl is ready and the customer is demanding, you need to supply the vinyl to the customer. So there should be an outbound logistics. So the logistics will be an issue in value chain. Value chain means what? Whatever activities we are conducting in the organization, all those activities, combination of activities, give us revenue, give us profit. Similarly, in my organization, the training classes, live recording, study material, the giving the software and everything, accounting job, everything is a value creation. Not one thing is giving me value, not one thing is giving me revenue or profit. All the activities, when carried on properly, then only they are going to give me the value. Then only the customer is interested in buying the product of the organization. So what are the activities relating to vinyl which the company need to conduct? They are explaining that in the value chain. Then maybe there are second part relating to business logic, whether the vinyl should be introduced or not, that is relating. How the answer is written? What should be the presentation of the answer? By looking at this. And it's not this paper. If you open any paper answer in last 7 years, the answers are written like this. What we will say? What type of style is this in writing the answers? I will say that generally Indian students, if you have given CA, CWA exam or BCom exam, we have the habit writing 20-25 points. Roman 1, one line. Roman 2, another line. Roman 3, another line. Roman 4, another line. We have this tendency. Indian student has this tendency. If you are going to write one line, one line, one line, one line, 25 lines, on all 25 lines, marks will be laddu, nothing. They are not writing Roman 1, Roman 2. They are writing the answers in a, even though I am saying this in the first class, but when the student will submit the answers, most of the student will write Roman 1, one line, Roman, whereas we are discussing in the first 1 hour only. That is not allowed. That is not allowed. The answer need to be written in paragraph format. The paragraph should be composed of 3-4 lines. It need not necessarily be 8 lines. Because maybe they have written the answer 8 lines paragraph. They have not written the answer in 45 minutes. They have done a huge research, 10-12 persons involved. Then in 4-5 days, the answer is written. You can't compete with them. But obviously, we need to understand the logic the way they are writing. So they are writing the answers in paragraph format. Whether you want to heading the paragraph or not, doesn't matter. They have not put any heading. They are just heading the first point, that is value chain. The second point, which is relating to business logic. This may be the B part and the first one is A part. You need to explain your thought process in the paragraph. And in different paragraph, you need to write different aspects. You need to focus that you will be writing your answers in 3-4 paragraphs. They have written for the first part, 4 paragraphs only. And they have written for the second part also 4 paragraphs only. Maybe sometimes you will find in suggested answer 5-7 paragraphs, but they are suggesting that the student need to write 3-4 paragraphs. In every paragraph, they need to write different aspect. Suppose this is relating to value chain. According to me, this is not difficult to tackle. Maybe this is the first class. We have not discussed value chain. Maybe it's difficult. But normally in exam, value chain is not difficult for the students. Suppose this is relating to finance pillar. For finance pillar, you will see that in the question paper. This was the first question. 45 minutes gone, answer will be submitted. When you are going into the second question, the first answer, whatever you have submitted, will automatically be submitted in 45 minutes. Whether you have completed or not, it doesn't matter. 45 minutes over, whatever you have typed is gone. You are going in the second portion. The second scenario, again, reference material and all that. Again, you need to write the answer in 45 minutes. The third scenario. In the third scenario, they are asking the second question. Identify the key accounting ratios that will be affected by this venture and explain whether they will improve or deteriorate the financials of the company. There is no need to calculate ratios. They are not asking any calculator. Secondly, identify the key accounting ratios that will be affected by this venture and explain whether they will improve or deteriorate. That is the ratios which you will say whether they will improve or whether they will deteriorate. There is no need to calculate the ratios. Even though they have not written, we are not required to calculate ratios in exam. So from where we will comment? In the reference material, they have not given any ratio. Here they are also not giving any ratio. How I will comment? In the pre-seen material, the financial statement is given. I will calculate ratios 50 days before the exam only on the basis of all the data. And we will analyze in the class all the ratios at length. So if the question on ratios, we should be very well ready before the exam only. But then what they are writing? The most immediate change in is that we would expect travel return on capital employed to increase. They are saying that when we will launch Vinyl, then the return on capital employed will increase. Why? Operating profit will increase because we will be selling a new line at a profit with no meaningful increase in the capital employed. Return on capital employed is EBIT, earning before interest and tax, divided by capital employed. They are saying that by going into the Vinyl, there is no further investment required in the business. But the income, the sales and the income will increase. So income divided by same capital will increase. Operating profit will increase because we will be selling a new line at a profit with no meaningful increase in the capital employed. Any increase in ROCE is to be welcomed as an improvement because the company will be seen to be generating an additional return from the investment that has been made in it. That means by the investment, the company will be able to generate additional return. There is no investment, only the income will increase, return on capital employed. The first paragraph focused on return on capital employed. Second paragraph, travel asset turnover will increase. Asset turnover means sales divided by assets. Since there is no increase in assets, only the sale will increase. So asset turnover will increase. That means with the same assets, we will be able to generate more and more sales. The new line will increase revenue without the need for any additional investment in property, plant and equipment. That increase will be viewed as an improvement because it will indicate that the travel is using the asset base more efficiently. The first paragraph on ROC, the second paragraph on asset turnover, the third paragraph, the travel gross profit percentage will change. If we assume that the margin on sales of Vinyl is greater than on digital sales. Why? Because the Vinyl sale price is very high. So the margin will be high. Because Vinyl is a premium product. Then the addition to the high margin sales will increase the gross profit margin. Percentage. Changes in the gross profit can be difficult to interpret. But this change should be viewed as an improvement. Because the company has been struggling with poor profitability. And so the shareholders will be pleased to see that percentage has increased. Maybe the last 2 years data which was given in the pre-seen, the performance was not good. But with this, they are saying that the performance will improve. So the first paragraph, return on capital employed. Second paragraph, sales turnover. Third paragraph, gross profit margin. Fourth paragraph, the current ratio will be affected because in the first instance, inventories of record will increase. That is because of phenyl, the inventory level will increase. With a matching decrease in cash for making that inventory, the cash involvement will be there. Reduction in cash, increase in inventory. After all, payment to Stempress is due on delivery. That will have no impact on the current ratio because cash is going down, inventory is going up. So current asset remaining more or less same. That will have no impact on the current ratio. The quick ratio will, however, decline because in the quick ratio, you don't take inventory. So if your inventory is increasing, you exclude inventory, but cash balance is going down, the quick ratio will be affected, which will make travel appear to be less liquid. The reduction in the bank could raise further concern for liquidity. That is, the fourth paragraph was relating to liquidity short-term solvency. The last paragraph, the inventory turnover ratio will also certainly increase because inventory turnover means sales by inventory. And inventory level will be very, very high because of phenyl. Maybe the sale is increasing, but they are saying that the effect of inventory will be high. So sales by inventory will be going down. If travel invests heavily in phenyl, then the proportionate increase in inventory will be far more significant than the increase in the cost of revenue. And so the number of days will increase significantly. And readers may assume that this is an indication of inefficiency on the part of travel's management. While more readers may recognize that it is difficult to determine a meaningful figure for this ratio because there is no fixed ratio for inventory turnover without a split between cost of sale and download and streaming and all that. In five paragraphs saying five things, but they are not saying anything without logic. It's not that they are saying return on capital employed will increase. Current ratio will decrease. Return on asset turnover. Why? They are giving logic why. Your logic, your write-up, your comma full stop cannot be seen. And never it will be seen. But you need to give logic in your write-up. This is relating to something which you can say that we will be discussing in the class based on pre-seen at least 4 to 5 times. So according to me, in the exam, if the question is on ratio analysis, it's a very easy question. Because that we discuss in the class at length always. But still on the last class, when I give for the doubt class, a student go on asking, sir, ratio fir se. Because they are not, concentrating on technical study. Not concentrating when the classes are over, going through the ratios, writing on their own, they are not doing. What is to be done, I will be telling. This is just one more answer I am reading. This is again relating to F2. This is relating to maybe goodwill calculation. IFRS 3 business combination. It states that goodwill is determined after recognizing and measuring the identifiable assets acquired and the liabilities assumed in the acquisition. That may be complicated by the fact that travel may be traded with Stempress already. And so some of the assets acquired may have been acquired through some previous and separate transaction. Travel will have to keep careful records of the business it does with the Stempress during the negotiation leading up to final question of the company. That is, you can say that what will be the problem in calculating goodwill. First paragraph. Stempress owns significant quantities of sophisticated and specialized products and machinery that will have to be valued at its fair value. Travel will have to consider how the nature of the business and its technology will affect the fair value. It may be that equipment has very little sale value unless it is being used to vinyl production. They are saying that how the fair value of sophisticated asset will be determined. The fair value measurement permits fair value to be determined based on their highest and best use. That makes it possible to make account of the present value. They are saying that how we will be able to determine the fair value as per IFRS 13. Stempress owns significant intellectual property in the form of patents. That should be taken into account in determining the goodwill. These might be difficult to value because they are specialized nature and because of the lack of an observable market. It would, however, be potentially misleading to exclude the asset for the goodwill calculation because they were undoubtedly a significant reason for a travel acquisition for Stempress. In this paragraph, they are focusing on valuation of patent, that how we can do the valuation of the patent for goodwill calculation. Then the last paragraph, the valuation of liabilities may be complicated by the fact that some assets are leased. The value of the leases will have to be evaluated in terms of future cash flows and expected of their fair values. It may not be appropriate to reflect the book value of liabilities As shown in the stamp press financial statement, Travel will also have to consider whether there are any unrecorded provisions or other liabilities that should be taken into account in calculating goodwill. I have read three questions answer, not read the question, not read the scenario, just for giving a warm up. The one was relating to value chain. The second was relating to ratios. The third was relating to group accounting goodwill valuation. Whatever we will study in future, you will study. What do you think? Which one is more difficult to write? The value chain one? Everybody need to say. Whether value chain, whether the ratio analysis, whether this goodwill part. Which one in the exam will be difficult to write? Think logically. Think logically. If you are in the exam hall, which portion you will find more challenge to write the answers? Not F2. There are three questions I read in the class. Not F2. The first question was relating to value chain. The second question was relating to ratio analysis. The third is relating to goodwill. Normally, even though we all are saying goodwill, but you will find that in the class when I will be taking last class, many of you will be asking ratios also. Many of you. But nobody will be asking in the last class if there is a problem in value chain. Maybe for the time being I have not taught value chain, you can say. But believe me, when we will be in the last class, the student will be facing problem in this. How can we cover up this? What is the way by which the standard of writing is paragraph format? No Roman 1, Roman 2, no one-liner. In every paragraph, there is a different thing you need to explain properly. You will say just that marking guidelines. Just I am opening the marking guidelines. This is the marking guidance given by the SEMA Institute for this variant. Suppose I am reading what they are writing. This marking scheme has been prepared for SEMA 2019 professional qualification, which is February 2020. This indicate answers will show the expected or most orthodox approach. However, the nature of the case study examination task means that a range of responses will be valid. The descriptions within this level based marking scheme are holistic and can accommodate a range of acceptable responses. General marking guidance is given below. Markers are subject to extensive training. I cannot become markup without training by the SEMA Institute. It's not that anybody can become markup. And marker are need to be in a team. It's not one markup. 10-12 markers are there always together. And standardization activities and ongoing monitoring to ensure and judgment are being made. Care must be taken not to make too many assumptions about future marking schemes on the basis of this document. While guiding principle remain constant, details are changing depending upon the requirement. Marking schemes should be applied positively with candidates reward for what they demonstrate and not penalized for what they are not writing. Whatever you have written on that, you will be getting marks. Whatever you have not written, forget about that. All marks on the scheme are designed to be awarded and full marks would be awarded when all descriptions criteria are met. The marking scheme and indicative answers are provided as a guide to markers. They are not intended to be exhaustive and other valid approaches are possible. Students do not have to make all of the points which are written in the model answers. An answer which does not address the requirements of the task will be awarded 0. Markers would mark according to the marking scheme and not their perception of when the passing standard may. Markers would mark according to the marking scheme, not their own perception. The marking scheme will be decided by 10-12 teachers. Select a mark with the level 1 second. I'm not reading that because it is waste of time. Suppose in the first point section 1, the 50-50% are there. Now they are saying that in section 1, that is the value chain 1. The value chain, no rewardable marks, 0. Why? Because actually the student has not written anything relating to value chain. The marks will be 0. Level 1, that means the student is not 0, but very bad. Offers a brief overview of changes to the value chain. 1 mark. level 2 student, better than level 1, offers a clear overview of changes to the value chain 2 to 3 marks. And a fantastic student, overview of the changes to value chain 4 marks. 4 marks means what? I will say that, suppose you are saying about value chain, suppose primary activities, inbound, operating, outbound, logistics, whatever. You are stating in a paragraph relating to primary activities. That means technically you know what is primary activities. You are correlating with the scenario. That why you are stating that inbound operations or outbound, you are explaining them. That means according to me, you are coming into this 4 marks category. So I will be giving you for that paragraph 4 out of 4. Then I can say that you are going in the second paragraph. You are saying the what is the problem in the value chain with the vinyl. You are focusing on mainly you can say that it's related with logistics or inventory management. And you are explaining that. Again, I will give you 4 marks. For every paragraph, I'm going to give you 4 marks, 4 marks, 4 marks. So suppose I have decided that for the point A, 50%, I'm going to give to the students for 4 points, 4 paragraphs, 4 into 4, 16 marks. Similarly, for the second question, 4 into 4, 16 marks. That means in the first portion, how much marks I'm going to give you? 16, 16, 32. The question paper is of 150 marks. 32 into 4. How much it is coming? 32 into 4. It is coming around 128. Maybe suppose I will say that it's 5 marks. I mean to say that every question is 45 minutes. In 45 minutes, there are two parts, 50-50%. In 45 minutes, suppose I am taking around 10 minutes in reading what scenario they have given, which is unseen, which is not pre-seen. On the day of exam, unseen reference material, the requirement will be given. The question will be given on the day of exam, not in advance. It's not that the pre-seen material is giving the set of questions. On the day of exam, 5 sets of papers, 6 sets of papers will be there. In every set of paper, 4 questions. Section 1, section 2, section 3, section 4. Section 1, 45 minutes. Section 2, 45 minutes. Section 3, 45 minutes. Section 4, 45 minutes. In every section, there may be 2 tasks. There may be 3 tasks, A, B, C. There may be 4 tasks, A, B, C, D. If it is 4 tasks, very lengthy. But you need to answer all within 45 minutes. So out of 45 minutes, around 10 minutes reading the scenario, planning what you will be writing will be going. We will be discussing when based on the pre-seen questions. You will see that planning the answer, thinking about that 10 minutes gone. So you are getting effectively 35 minutes to write. In 1 minute, the typing speed should be around 1.5 line. So 35 minutes means 35 into 1.5. That is coming around 53, 55 line answer. So your answer of one section, maybe it's A, B, 2 tasks, maybe A, B, C, 3 tasks. The total write-up will be around 50, 55 lines. Those 50, 55 lines you need to write in section 1, section 2, section 3, section 4. Somebody will say that if I write 70 lines, very well. But not that the question, marks is available on quantity. Marks is available on quality. But suppose somebody will say that I will write 30 lines, very bad. Because 30 lines, you will not be able to convey what do you want to convey. So the answer is very bad. The marks will be very less. Suppose you are writing 55 lines, but you are not writing anything whatever is asked in the question. Maybe 55 lines, marks will be laddu, nothing. Because you are not writing what is asked in the question. So the most important part is writing the answers as per the requirement. Now, suppose I am going into whatever materials I am using in the class. Don't take tension. Once the class will be over, all these materials I will share with you in the mail. That is MCS first class notes, MCS second class notes. Whatever I will be writing in the class slides, I will share after the class. Don't worry. You just concentrate in the class on understanding the thing. Just one second. What they are saying, overall the standard of answers in this August 19 exam was reasonable. There were, however, many poorly written answers. These candidates demonstrated very little knowledge or application of the scenario. The main problem, it is written in every marking guideline. The main problem as usual was that the candidate were not answering what was asked. The main problem which is written in every marking guideline answers that the candidate were not answering what was asked and we are failing to draw on information from the exhibits and the pre-seen. That is, whatever information scenario given in the question paper unseen, which is on the day of exam, the scenario, reference material and the pre-seen material knowledge, the student is not able to produce that knowledge in the exam. They are writing something which is not asked in the question, and because of that, the student is not able to pass the exam. That's the reason. They are mentioning always that the problem is that the answer's format is not the way it should be. It is not in the paragraph format. It is number 1, number 2, Roman 1, Roman 2 like that. Whether you write Roman 1 or Roman 1, ABCD doesn't matter. It has to be in paragraph format. Whether you want to keep an heading of the paragraph doesn't matter. You have to answer in paragraph format for entire paper. And in every paragraph, you need to answer what you are going to state in one paragraph, another paragraph different, another paragraph different. How can I can see that we will be able to achieve this in coming 50 days? Suppose, how to study in coming 50 days. That's the story. Suppose I thought that 1st April 2021, I will study group accounting. Suppose I decided that on 1st April 2021, I will study group accounting. For the YouTube video, I will see the group accounting story. What is actually consolidation, parent subsidiary, why the group financial statements are prepared. I will understand the logic. Okay. Maybe suppose on 2nd April also, I will study some basic adjustments relating to group accounting. Now, when I will be studying the adjustments, I need to understand that in the exam, they are not going to ask me calculate goodwill. They are not going to ask me what is the value of non-controlling interest. They are not going to ask me prepare the balance sheet. They are not going to ask me prepare the PL account. So if you are referring the study text of Kaplan or anything, and the group accounting is written, say, around 350 pages, in that they have solved many problems, and you started solving problems, you are actually wasting your time. Because that is not the case study exam. Why you are solving problems? That is not going to be asked in the exam. When you have studied the basic structure of consolidation, why the consolidation is required, what is the purpose, what is the basic logic behind preparation of consolidation, and some basic adjustment, what is goodwill and NCI, you understood. Not solving the question. What is the next story? Write one or two pages in Word file about what you studied. This will help you in two ways. One is that whatever you are studying, you can communicate, you can write that. That means your study is perfect. And the second, in exam, you need to type with the keyboard on the screen in a Word file. It's not exactly a Word file, I can say. This is not exactly a Word file, but it's actually a Word file only. Not all the features of the Word file are there. Whatever the features are applicable is this much only. In a normal Word file, the features are many. Here, the features are less. But then you are actually typing in a Word file. Maybe in our working culture, wherever we are working, we are on computer only, mailing to the clients, mailing to the customers, or communicating with anybody. We are always on mail, social media and all that, Word file only. But generally, we have given exam how? Copy pen based. We have not generally experienced or given the exam on computer based. And on one single day, suppose for 49 days, you are studying still on copy pen based. And on the day of exam, everything you will be able to do on computer. You can't. Because that habit you have not developed. You need to practice of typing on the screen with the keyboard, thinking, typing. So make a point that every day you will be writing one or two pages, whatever you have studied. Whether it's consolidation, value chain, ratio analysis, total quality, whatever, man. Whatever you are studying, you will be making a summary of your study. That what you studied today, in that what you have understood. That will help you to remember that thing for a longer time, and that will increase your typing speed, your typing skill. So make a point, make a schedule that for coming 30, 35, 40 days, 10 days before the exam, up till 10th of May, how I am going to complete the entire syllabus. What is my routine? That you don't have to share with me. Many times the student becomes very low level student. Low level in the sense, sir, I have made this routine. It's upon you, sir. The routine will not be able to be achieved if you are not stick to the routine. You don't have to shout to everybody or to me, to anybody, I have made this routine. It's for you. You have to achieve your target. You have to be professional in coming 50 days. Whatever you have done in the past, forget. But whatever you will study, you need to write. Suppose you are doing the YouTube videos, 20-25 hour. You have seen all the videos. You will say that, sir, I have done everything. But actually, if you are just seeing the video, not writing anything, you will never be able to understand anything. It's not possible. It's not yours. Unless and until you are not writing it down, what you have studied. If the consolidation lecture, I am saying 2.5 hours, why the consolidation is there? What is the purpose behind consolidation? You will say that I have understood everything. Everybody is understanding. But how much you can write on your own? After understanding, what you can replicate? What you can write in your own language? And you cannot mug up anything. You have to write in your own language only. So you need to develop your writing speed. If you can type 1.5 line in 1 minute, it's average. If you can write in 1 minute, 2 lines, 2.5 line, it's good. What's the problem? Then in that case, in less time also in exam, you can type more and more. Your length of the answer will be more adequate, which will be helping you to get more marks. So for that reason, it cannot be prepared on one single day. It's a practice should be start from now only. From today only, you should bring in your culture that for coming 50 days, I will study like that. Just by looking at the videos, joining the class will not help. You have to practice on your own. The exam is 150 marks, as I said. The pass marks is 80 out of 150. You can say that they are saying that the examiner is actually marking you out of 100 marks. Suppose every question, section 1, section 2, section 3, section 4, It's 25 marks, 25 marks, 25 marks, 25 marks. Suppose I have given you out of 100 marks as an examiner, I have given you out of 100 marks 60. That means out of 150 is how much? 90. In 100 you scored 60. So in 150, 90. So when you will be, when the result will be declared for you, the result will be saying that Niven scored 90 marks out of 150. The pass marks is 80. 80 by 150 is coming 53%. But 53% is not pass marks. The different type of variant, variant 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the different variants which they will be giving, they are not of the same standard. Some of the variant questions are easier. Some of the variants questions are difficult. Some of the variants questions are average. Who will decide that? The examining team. Whether they will say to us which is easy, which is difficult, they will not say. They will not say in marking guidelines also. It is understanding to them. So if I am getting a difficult variant, maybe I am scoring 45%, I will pass. Because it will be weighted average to higher marks. Suppose I am getting out of 148. So out of 150, it is 48 plus 24, 72. But that was the difficult variant. And the examiner has already decided that in that variant, whatever marks the student will obtain, it will be done 115%. So 72 into 115%, it is greater than 80. Pass. Suppose I got a very easy variant. And in that, the examiner has already decided, whatever the student will score, it will be done 90%. So I scored out of 155. So out of 150, 55 plus 27.5, which is 83.5, 84. But the marks is 84 into 90%. Failed. So we don't know which variant is what marks. We generally say that as a safe side, we need to score at least greater than 55% marks. You can say 80 by 150, 53%, but it depends upon variant to variant. Every variant marks is weighted average. They will be multiplied by 90%, 115%. Maybe for an average variant, it is 100%. The SEMA Institute is not disclosing to anybody that which variant is difficult, which is easy and all that. The last thing. Suppose I am giving exam on 19th. And Niven is giving exam on 21st. After 2 days, 19, 20, 21st, May 3 days exams are there. Now Niven know me. Niven called me. Prakash, what came in the exam? Which variant you got? Actually, it is not written in the exam hall. This is variant 1 or 2. But just that, what questions you got? Suppose I will say to Niven, the question was there on value chain. I will say to Niven, the question was there on goodwill adjustments relating to consolidation. I will say remain, the question was there on ratio analysis. What we will do in 50 days? Are we not going to discuss value chain, goodwill, ratio analysis? Are we not going to discuss? So what extra knowledge Niven is getting by getting a communication from me? That on 19th, the variant which I got, in the variant value chain, goodwill and ratio analysis was there. That we already know that the question will be from the syllabus only. It cannot be out of the syllabus. Niven is not getting any benefit. Because exactly what was detail given in the scenario, I cannot remember. I cannot help to Niven. So whether the student giving exam on 19th or 21st, whether the student is communicating with the other student, no benefit. It's just waste of time. And there is no limit for the questions what can come in the exam. We will be practicing different type of questions in the class, but nothing will be, you can say that question will be coming in exam. What is our objective? With a different types of questions covering most of the portion of the syllabus. I generally always try in my classes that with a different types of question, we should be able to cover at least 70 to 80% of E2, P2, F2. That means if 70 to 80% we discuss, that means in the exam, whatever will come, 70 to 80% will be coming out of our discussion. Not the same question, not the same scenario, but that thing we had discussed in the class. And when the discussion has been done, a question has been done in the class, you all involved into the discussion, then you will be in a better position to answer. My responsibility and your expectation is not that whatever we'll be doing in the class, same thing will be coming in exam. Never. Every scenario will be different. But whatever we are discussing in the class, that will be definitely coming 70 to 80% in exam. And my job is to make you convenient, make you feeling better, that whatever will come, you can write the answer. That feeling I need to develop in you. Not that what type of question will come, what exactly will come in the exam. My job is to make you feel better, that whatever will come in the exam, you are very well prepared. I can answer any type of question that I want. So I can say that this is a case study exam and the institute is saying that the student need to prepare in this direction. How we are going to cover our classes? The first class is not finished. I will be taking at least 1.5 hours more, but just that, the first class I have written just introduction of case study, some here and there discussion and all that, core areas and all that. The second class, the pre-seen will be out tomorrow. I will be studying on the basis of the pre-seen. It's around 25-30 pages material. Will do my research, bring prepare some material. So it requires time. It cannot be done in 1 or 2 hours. Reading the 30 pages properly requires 1.5 hours, 2 hours. One time reading is not enough. I need to read it again next time, understand it properly. And then I can say that I will be making my notes. You can say different one by one. So I will be ready with the notes in at least 5-7 days. So you can see that when I will be ready with the first class notes, I don't have notes because material will come tomorrow. Earlier, SEMA Institute used to share with us earlier. Now they are not. So for that reason, I will be getting the material tomorrow only like you. So I will be preparing the material will be released by tomorrow evening because UK time evening around 3-4 o'clock. At that time, we all get the material. I will share the material with all of you. Many times students say that, sir, mereko nahi mila. I will mail the material once I will get all of you in the mail. There is no problem. Today I don't have. So I will be taking around 5-7 days to prepare the material. Then in the first class, I mean to say this is not treated as a first class. If then that is the first class, we will be discussing the pre-seen material here and there in around 2 hours. I will just request all of you that when our class will be there, you read the pre-seen materials at least 2 times. That's my request. So that I don't have to waste time in the class on reading the English. Even you don't like also. You read the material when tomorrow it will be released. Maybe tomorrow or day after tomorrow 1 time. And maybe 1 more time again after 3-4 days. 2 times you read before the next class. So the pre-seen discussion we will be doing. The business, the important areas and all that. We will be discussing SWOT analysis, financial analysis of the company, internal, external analysis, core areas, relating to core areas. My target is to cover maximum portion, but I have just written, suppose, core area A and B. Once the next class will be over, not this class, because presently we don't have any material. When the tomorrow material will release and I will take the next class, when that next class is over, then at least up till core area A and B, I will complete the basic discussion about core area A and B. I will be giving you questions for homework after the next class. Relating to core area A, there will be some questions. Relating to core area B, there will be some questions. Relating to core area C, there will be some questions. Suppose I will share A, B, C, 3 core areas questions. Every core area will involve 3-4 questions. So you can see 12-13 questions I will share. And in the next class, I will already discuss the core area A and B. That means the questions you should be able to handle. Now you will be writing the answers. How you will be writing the answers? Relating to any question which I have given in core area A, you can open the books. You can open my notes. Coming. What are core areas I am coming? When I will ask in the class, is there any doubt? Believe me, everybody will say no doubt. Up till now, I have not said this. You need to give me time. How I will explain everything in 1 second. Don't worry. So I am saying that suppose after the next class, suppose next class is on say 10th. So suppose 10th, 8 o'clock, the class is over. On 8.05 p.m., I will give you A, B, C mock papers. I will give you relating to core area A, core area B, core area C, question paper. I have discussed already, then I am giving you question. But suppose when you are opening the core area A questions, you are not understanding what to write and all that. I will be saying you, which I am saying now only. The questions area, you can read from the books. You can read from Kaplan. You can read from my PowerPoint. You can read from Google, from wherever you want, man. And then you write the answer. But don't copy paste the answer from anywhere. Don't copy paste the sentences from anywhere. My suggestion is that suppose you are writing the answer for core area A, a particular question. In that question, suppose there is a question relating to value chain. Now, suppose you don't know anything, even though we discussed in the class, you forget. You read the value chain from Google, maybe from Kaplan, maybe from Ninos. After reading, close this. Now, write the value chain answer on your own. Because from wherever you are reading only technical area. Relating to the case study, relating to the industry, the value chain need to be written by you. So, you will be writing the answers for the value chain the way we have discussed in the class. In the paragraph format, 3-4 paragraphs, in every paragraph, different aspect you will be writing. Whether your answer is good or bad, forget. You are giving an open book exam. I am asking you, open the book, open the material, open the Google, then write the answers. But don't copy paste, write in your own sentences. Once your core area A answers are complete, suppose you have completed core area A answer, I have given the paper on 10th, you completed core area A answer on 13th of April. Suppose you will mail us. You will mail your answer core area A 13th of April. How you will mail? Please don't mail. Suppose in core area A, I have given 4 questions. You will mail 1 question answer today, 1 tomorrow, 1 day after tomorrow. I will puzzle from the mail. Core area A, all the answers in 1 word file. Don't make PDF. Otherwise, I will not be able to do amendment. Make 1 word file. The word file names would be what? Suppose it is submitted by Achal. So, you will be writing core area A answers, Achal. Yeah, Achal core area A answers. You will send 1 single file of that is core area A. Anybody submitting the answer, you need to name the file Nibain core area A answers. In 1 word file, all the questions of core area A. You will go on submitting till the next class A, B, C, whatever questions I have given. It's my job to check them in advance. And in the class, when I will be there in the 3rd class, then I will be ready with the outcome whatever you have written. Where you need to improve. Even though you have written the answers after referring books, but still where the loopholes are there. Where the improvement is required. So, I will be guiding you in the 3rd class for your improvement areas. So, in the 3rd class, I will be giving you feedback about your answers to all of you. And I will be discussing the balance core areas which we could not discuss in the 1st class. I mean to say in the 2nd class. So, we will discuss in the 3rd class the balance core areas. And I will be giving you the balance questions about D and E. Whatever is left, I will be giving you further mock papers. Again, you will be writing the answers before the next class about the balance core areas. Now, in the 4th class, I will be taking a test in the class. That is like exam. I will be giving you the first question. You need to submit the answer in 45 minutes. I will be giving you the second question. You need to give me the answers in 45 minutes. While writing the answer, just a request, don't refer any material. Because you have referred. That time is gone. Now forget referring material. Because it's not an open book exam in exam hall. You have to remember everything and then you need to write. So in the class, I will be taking a mock test where I am controlling on time also. Because when you were writing the answers for core area ABCD, then you were not focusing on time. You were writing 1 answer in 1 day. Reading the books, reading the material, then writing the answer. But in the 4th class, I will be taking the test. Assuming that you have to write the answers in 45 minutes. All 4 answers, 45 minutes each. How much you can write without referring the book? We will be getting a warm-up. That in the exam, we will not be getting the luxury. In the exam, we will not be getting greater than 45 minutes. In the exam, we cannot refer any other material. It's a closed book exam. That feeling you will be getting in the 4th class. Then in the fifth class, whatever answers you have given, I will be again evaluating. I will be coming with the conclusion. And before the fifth class, I will be giving you one more mock paper to all of you that you will be writing the answers. You don't have to submit the answer. But the fifth, before the fifth class, whatever mock I will give you, that mock answers you need to write exactly at a stretch in 3 hours. Earlier, when you have written the answer for A, B, C, D, E, you have taken huge time. You have referred material, books, Google. In fourth class, when I have taken the test, then I have asked you to write the answers in exactly 3 hours. 45, 45, 45, 45. But in the fifth class, before the fifth class, I will be giving you a further mock paper for which you will be writing the answer on your own as a genuine student, not referring any material or anything, at a stretch in 3 hours. At a stretch. Suppose you are 8 o'clock free, 8 to 11, you will write the entire answers without referring any book, anything. Then I will share the model answer. You will go through with the model answers. And then you are ready for the fifth class, whatever your queries are there, whatever your questions are there, relating to mock, relating to whatever we studied, something you want to revise again, something you want to discuss again, or maybe if anybody don't have any doubt, I will be start asking questions in the class, so which will be our fifth class and the last class, which is, you can say, if 19th Tuesday or Wednesday is the exam, then it is the previous Saturday. That way the class will be there, so that we will be able to cover everything in all these 5 classes. That's the way we are going to perform. That every day has a target which we want to achieve on our own. Means for you. 1st April, 2nd April, 3rd April, 4th April. What I need to achieve. And in the class, how I am going to cover one by one the different core areas in the class. Now, technically speaking, what are the core areas? If anybody has done my YouTube videos, which is freely available, then the first class I discuss these core areas only, which I am discussing now. In the first class, I discuss always the core areas. Those are freely available. That is, you can say November MCS 2020, the core area in the first class. This is given by the SEMA Institute only. 5 core areas for the management case study. One is core activity A, which is saying evaluate opportunities to add value. What is evaluate opportunities? Suppose the question paper of February 2020. It was saying that the company want to launch a product vinyl. They want to sell the music through the vinyl medium. Whether that is a good strategy? Whether the company should be doing that? Can I comment about that strategy? Can I help the board members about whether the companies would be going for vinyl production, selling the music through the vinyl, whether the companies would be doing that? That I need to do in this core activity A. It's just that they are saying that everything I can, I can, I can, I can. So core area A, I can. Select appropriate capital investment appraisal techniques and apply them in order to support capital investment decisions, including products, service development, digital transformation, everything. I can say that if we go in single word, in the P2 syllabus, we have the investment appraisal. 2 topics are there. Basic investment, advanced investment appraisal. That is called the select appropriate capital investment. That is, what is capital investment, calculation of cash flows, NPV, IRR, profitability index, capital rationing, whatever. That they are saying as first part. That is, in any project, it is very important that the project should be financially viable. So can I help the organization in taking a financial decision properly? Because this is the most important job of a finance manager. So they are saying that this is core area A. I can identify and use relevant digital data source to assist in capital investment decisions. We are saying that suppose company is launching its new website. Whether the launching of the website will help the company to develop their business, whether the companies would be doing that, can we help them? Can I explain the pricing strategies? whether it's a penetrating strategy, skimming pricing policy, premium pricing, what type of pricing strategy the companies would follow. Can I can select and implement suitable business model that will create value for stakeholders? Business model in the context of digital ecosystem, the business model are, you can say, NSOF model. Market development, product development, market penetrations, different types of strategies are there. Can I say on the basis of that, whether the companies would be doing that? I can analyze the impact of disruptive and digital operating business models in the context of digital ecosystem. Because I can say that in the corona, the business which are based online, they are actually able to survive. Those businesses which are very much dependent on physical place, physical thing, they are destroyed fully. And the corona is again started. You all know that, as I was saying earlier in the beginning also. It's maybe in UK, but now in India, it is warming up. The cases are continuously increasing. And those businesses which are based on digital, IT and all that, they are able to survive, otherwise not. Can we write in the exam relating to corona? Earlier, they were saying that in 2020, the answer should not be covering corona. But now, they have realized that it is a never-ending process now. It's not a fear of 2020, it is coming in 2021 also. The people has to stay, the people has to live their life along with the corona only. They are saying that you can give the answers based on corona, but not that you will start writing from the beginning till the end only corona. A justified point on corona is relevant, but not that you will base your every write-up as a corona-affected business only. It's the normal business scenario where there was no corona, there is no corona, there will not be any corona. You need to deal with those things also. But not that you cannot write your answers based on corona. But earlier in the previous case study in 2020, they said that the students would assume while writing the answers that it's a normal business scenario. There is no natural calamity or nothing. But now they have changed their stance. They are saying that the student can write the answers based on corona, but it should not be that you will writing only corona. You have to be normal business sense also. When the pre-seen material will be released tomorrow, you will find that a specific paragraph must be devoted on that to all the students, whether you can write up on corona or not. So you can say that analyze the impact of disruptive technology. I can explain the relevance of weighted average cost of capital. Weighted average cost of capital is in F2 syllabus. If I will go with these sentences and with the syllabus, then P2 capital budgeting, E2 business model, NSOF or Porter's business model, E2 IT area, E2 project management area, not that much it is there in core area 2. E2 values of primary activities, problem solutions, HR infrastructure. If we will be going into detail of whatever the meaning of the things, then you can see that students should not have zero knowledge in these areas. Capital budgeting, basic understanding, the process of capital budgeting, NPV, IRR, payback, which one is better and all that, they should be having minimum knowledge. I said they will not ask any calculator use. They will not ask you to calculate weighted average cost of capital, NPV, goodwill calculation, balance sheet preparation, nothing. Because it's not a calculation based exam. The calculation will be done by them. WACC, NPV, balance sheet, PL, everything will be done by them. You just need to analyze those things. You need to say that on the basis of the cash flows given, on the basis of the NPV given, whether we should be accepting the project or not. Why we should be accepting the project based on NPV? Why we are not using the other methods? That type of question. No calculations are involved. Calculator are not required in the exam. But we will be taking calculator. That's other thing. So I can say that a zero knowledge relating to this area is not allowed. A basic understanding about core area A students should be having. Then the core area B, which is saying implementing the senior management decision. The company decided that they will be going for vinyl production. They will be selling the good money vinyl music. Now how it will be done? How the vinyl will be sourced, whether it will be manufactured, whether it will be purchased from outside, how the demand will be created, how the marketing will be done, what should be the pricing, all these things need to be decided. Implementing the decision. I can apply appropriate project management tools and techniques to effectively manage projects at appropriate stage. Suppose while doing implementing the project, there is some problem with a supplier, with a person, with a staff, how you will be dealing with the issue. There can be any unethical issue. I can identify key project personnel, explain their responsibilities for doing the project. There are different persons. They have different responsibility. Who should be doing what? I can select and apply suitable tools and techniques for managing risk and uncertainty. I can suitably finance sources and explain the characteristics of difference funding, the source of funding, which is in F2. I can recognize the characteristics of high performing team, the team performance, norming, forming, storming, then the other difference are there. Whether you write that or not, that's other thing. But at least one go, some readings should be there so that a basic understanding will be relevant relating to this portion. In my language, the interpretation of those broad I can is project evaluation, risk and uncertainty in P2, source of funding in F2, team building HR in E2. Core activity C, which is managing performance and cost to add value for the organization. Managing performance, that is, those who are doing certain task, any work, are they doing it properly? How we should be measuring their performance, mainly related with P2. Advice on measurement, analysis, and reporting on the performance of responsibility centers. Cost center, profit center, investment center, how their performance should be evaluated. I can analyze and process needed to ensure employee engagement, empowerment, alignment to enhance individual and team performance. I can corporate leadership. I can use cost management techniques, ABC, TQM. I can identify, apply appropriate quality management techniques. I can identify and value management techniques to enhance value. Value chain is here also. So key performance indicators, critical success factor, leadership management for E2 and P2, cost control, benchmarking, divisional investment centers, divisional analysis, responsibility centers, TQM, all these things are there with related to P2. That is, in core area C, they are focusing mainly on E2 and P2. Up till now, F2 part was very less. Now in point number D and E, F2 part is bharti. That is measuring performance. The measuring performance based on financial statement, ratio analysis. If we will take any decision, how it is going to affect the financial statement, that is also measuring performance. I can select, apply suitable tools and techniques for reasoning risk and uncertainty. I can select and apply suitable tools and techniques for managing risk and uncertainty in business model. Suppose we are going for takeover. We are going to take over another organ, or we are going to install the plant on our own. What will be the risk involved into that? I can use financial statement, assess the performance. I can support managers by recommending alternative performance measures or accounting treatment of certain issues, accounting implications. So this is very much related with F2 and P2. For P2 risk management, F2 consolidation, treatment of expenditure, taxation, EPS, all the chapters of F2 are in this core area D. And then the core area E, which is the final part, which is said as managing internal and external stakeholders. Anybody can say, other than Karthik, who are the stakeholders of an organization? Other than Karthik, who are the stakeholders of an organization? Who are the stakeholders of an organization? Trade union shareholders, employee, customer. Those, I will say that, like Sahil, you were saying, it can be anybody who is affected by the business or anybody who is affecting the business, both. We divide the stakeholders into three categories: internal, external, and connected. Internal are management, directors, staff, employees. External are trade union, government, regulatory authorities. Connected are shareholders, customers, suppliers, financiers. All these are stakeholders. some are external, some are internal stakeholders analysis. Can we manage all the stakeholders? I can explain the financial reporting implications. I can explain the behavior and transfer pricing on the internal or external stakeholders. Implications of integrated reporting. You can say integrated reporting in 2015 syllabus was only there in strategic level. But it is incorporated in F2 syllabus and it is management level integrated reporting after the 2019 syllabus. I can advise the communication process. I can advise negotiation. I can advise the conflict management. So E2 ANSOS model stakeholders analysis. Then you can say Mandelor's metrics also. E2 conflict relationship. F2 group accounting. Because group accounting they have said. So accounting part is there in core area D and E more. Earlier the accounting part was there relating to cost of capital and capital structure. These are five core areas which the institute has said since 2019 syllabus. That is 2020 case study and 21 and further 3 years exams will be based on this understanding of these core areas. So we should have a target that every 3 days we will be covering one more core areas on our own. That in core area A, I will cover in 3 days. Core area B, I will cover in 3 days. So in 10-15 days, I will cover all the core areas basically. Not mugging up, reading something, maybe looking at the videos and all that, and then making a write-up of your own. Suppose you have studied ANSOS model. Write one page about ANSOS model, what you have studied. Whatever you study, you have to write something. Then only the rhythm will come. And that you need to make a routine. These all things, core area A, B, C, D, we will discuss in a dual way. What is dual way? When I will be discussing value chain, I will be saying technically value chain is divided primary activities, support activities. What are primary activities, support activities? But then from tomorrow, we will have the pre-scene and we know the industry. So in that industry, in that company, what value chain is applicable? I will be correlating the practicality and the technicality. Technicality is knowing the value chain. Primary, support activity, inbound, operations, outbound, infrastructure, human resource. That is technical. But when the pre-seen material will be there, then I will be able to apply that technical knowledge on that case study, on that material. So that both the things we will be able to cover together. That is application of our bookish knowledge, technical knowledge on the basis of the case study which is applicable for us. And that case study will be relevant for May exam also, August exam also. Because from 2020-19 syllabus, they are saying two terms, the same case study. Up till 2019 exam for every term, four exams in a year, four case study, four pre-seen material. But now from 2020 onwards, last year, current year and coming 3 years, for two terms, the pre-seen material is same. May, August, same. November, February, same. May, August, same like that. So whatever the pre-seen material will be released tomorrow, that will be applicable for May 2021 exam and August 2021 exam. For that reason, if suppose anybody in the class not giving exam in May, or maybe bad thing I am saying, given the exam but could not qualify, then that person will be giving exam in August. For August, there will not be any separate live classes. These classes all will be relevant for August exam also. I will be sharing two more mock papers for August exam. You can solve that. I will be sharing the model answers, not checking the evaluation process and all that. All the classes which we are doing now will be relevant for August. There will not be any separate live classes for August. The same classes will be relevant for August. The same material will be relevant for August. The same discussion will be relevant for August. Just for August, we will be sharing extra mock papers so that those who are not giving exam or those who gave the exam could not qualify, they will be able to study again with extra mock papers. But the study will remain same. Again, the live classes will be there for November 2021 case study, not for August. Because it's the same material, same study, so there is no separate live classes. But the question is that we should not be deferring the exam. There is no question. As I said always, we need to study 150 hours along with the classes. 50 days are there, 3 hours per day, 150 hours. Which 150 hours includes my classes also. Suppose I will be teaching 25 hours in the class. So you need to study on your own 125 hours. If you have already studied the YouTube videos and all that, then reduce out of 150 hour that much time. That's not a problem. If you have not studied anything, then take into call that every day you need to study 3 hours. Effective study, when you study, your mobile phones would be switched off, your rooms would be closed, nobody would be disturbing, and you should be studying properly for effectively 3 hours. Maybe 1.5 hour in the morning, 1.5 hour in the evening, or at a stress 3 hour as you are confident. And make a routine that this is my target for coming week. This is my target for coming 10 days. That way I need to complete. So whether you have studied earlier or not doesn't matter. You can easily pass the mock exam. I can just generally say that whatever mock papers I will be giving, you will be practicing in writing, you will be submitting the answers, and regularly when you are studying anything, you are always practicing in writing. You can't fail. The question of failure does not arise. 95% you will pass. 5% sometimes bad luck, good luck happens. That's other thing. But if somebody is not studying, not writing, not submitting the answers, then actually there is less than 5% chance of that student passing. It's pure result of your efforts. If you put your efforts, the results will be there. If you don't put your efforts, results will not be there. So up till now, what I was discussing, what is a case study exam? What is the format? What is a pre-seen material? How the exam questions are asked? How the answers need to be written? How we need to study? What is the passing criteria? How we are going to cover our classes and the basic knowledge of core area A, B, C, D, E. And in the coming classes, how you are going to study. When you will be writing the answers for core area A, B, C, D, E, you can refer the study material, Google everything. But when you will be in the fourth class, I am taking test, can't refer anything. Before the fifth class, when I will say another mock, can't refer anything. Those exams you will be giving in 3 hours without referring anything. So that you can analyze yourself that in the given 3 hours and without referring any material, how much you can write. But initially for coming 30 days, I'm not asking that we will be writing the answers without referring anything. This is study time. Once make up your study, do your study, and once April month is over, then in the May month, go into the next level. Abhi, we will start with gear 1, gear 2. Then in the May month, we will be going into gear 3, gear 4, gear 5. At that time, we will be in a position to write the answers in that format. When we will be studying in this 1 month, around 30-35 days in that direction. Relating to how the exams is there, what is the passing criteria, what we need to study, how we are going to cover our classes, what we are going to study, everything. Is there any question for the time being anybody has? Other than Karthik, anybody? I will say that not that much, but suppose you were writing something and because of your grammar or spelling mistake, I am not able to understand what you want to convey. Then I will not give you any marks. But if still I am able to understand because of your grammar or spelling mistake, then there is no deduction of marks. So it's interpretation. If I am not understanding, I will not give you marks. But if I am able to interpret, able to understand what you are communicating, even though spelling and grammar mistake is there, there is no deduction of marks. It is written categorically by the institute. It's not my say. So the major important thing is that you need to communicate effectively. Now, before proceeding to the next area, this is a material shared by the institute, I don't remember, around 2 months back. Whatever I have said in last 1.5 hour, all the things are written here by the institute. All the things. I will share this with all of you. section 1, 2, 3, 4 sections will be there. Then you are in the management level, management case study, E2, P2, F2, 3 subjects, knowledge is required. Then they are saying that you can see all the links are there. If I will click, I will going into that link. This is shared by SEMA Institute only. Obviously, when you all are registered, the SEMA Institute has shared with all of you also. But since they are sharing so many things, which one we will open, which one we will not open, we don't understand. Even when my team shared the notes through the Google Drive, in that Google Drive also this material is uploaded. So if you download, you will get that. I will share with all of you whatever I have said in this entire 1.5 hour, 2 hours, everything is written here, everything. The exam pattern, that the case studies for two terms are same. Everything is written here, everything. The core area A, B, C, D, in A, B, C, D, E2, P2, F2, breakup. Everything for passing, for what is the major important issues, everything. I have not gone through the way they have written, but my objective was that to cover this area. Now, just as a warm-up discussion, suppose this is a financial statement, hypothetical financial statement is given. The consolidated statement of PL account for the year ended 31st December 2019 and 2020. The figures are in dollar thousands. That is, triple zeros are not written and they are in dollar. Revenue, cost of revenue, gross profit, administrative expenses, selling and marketing expenses, operating profit, finance cost, taxation, profit for the year. An income statement of a company for the last year and the current year, December 2020, December 2019 is given to us. You concentrate on this income statement for 2-3 minutes and then what is your outcome by analyzing this data? I want a write-up from everybody in the chat box from all of you. Don't write now. Just take your time, go through with the data and then write 2-3 valid points or logical points which you are analyzing from the financials. operating profit has significantly increased due to the fact of increasing more sales in comparison to direct and indirect cost. Operating profit increased by 7.4% on account of increase in revenue and gross profit margin remains the same. On account of increase in revenue and gross profit margin remains the same. Okay. Economies of scale. Revenue increased by 6.38%. Okay. Anything else? Finance cost is low. It could be either due to repayment of loan or lower interest rate. They must pay back the loan. Anything else? Profit increased by 5% year on year. Need to check if revenue is increased due to existing product or additional range or segment introduced. Okay. Good. The company has demonstrated a natural growth irrespective of COVID. Okay. But in COVID, fast moving consumer good FMCG. Then I can say IT industry. Then I can say pharmaceutical are improving like anything, growing like anything. The COVID is positively affecting some of the industry and it is negatively affecting some of the industry. Entertainment, sports and all that are negatively affected. But then these industries, FMCG, pharmaceuticals are positively affected because of COVID. So, okay, chalega. Now, suppose when we are going to analyze in the practical life, not for the exam, and we are comparing the performance of this company with others or the performance of this company with earlier years in the past, anything. First of all, while analyzing the financials, we need to do some basic calculations. What are the basic calculations? Suppose I will calculate from 19 to 20, what is the percentage growth in each item? That is revenue from 92,557 to 98,465. What is the percentage growth in revenue? The cost of revenue from 34,715 to 36,542. What is the percentage increase in cost of revenue? The gross profit from 57 to 61. What is the percentage increase in gross profit? Every item, every single item, revenue, cost of revenue, gross profit, admin, selling, operating profit, finance cost, profit before tax, tax and profit for the year. Everything will be positive. Only the finance cost is negative. Because 114 to 60, there is a percentage down. Why we are calculating the percentage? Because the figure may be 1000, maybe 5000, maybe 50,000, maybe 500. But if we calculate in percentage, we will be able to analyze the change in a better way. This is one way. The other way is calculating certain percentages for 2020 and 2019 separately. Suppose gross profit margin 61,923 by 98,465, 57,842 by 92,557. Then administration expenses as a percentage of revenue 1143 divided by 98,465, 1097 by 92,557, 4262 by 98,465, 4134 by 92,557, 56,518 by 98,465, 52,611 by 92,557. I will calculate horizontal, vertical. both weigh the different ratios, different percentages. It's never possible that everything will be good and never possible that everything will be bad. Some of the things will be good, some of the things will be bad. What is our objective of doing these percentage analysis? That is there any different type of percentages which is coming, which is not logical? Is there anything coming exceptional, which is not a normal feature? Like suppose the sales is increasing by say around 7%. But the selling and marketing cost is increasing by 20%. The selling and marketing expenses are increasing by 20%. And the sales is increasing by 7%. We can say that the sale has gone up, the gross profit margin is good. But the selling and marketing expenses are in direct proportion to the sales. If the sales and marketing expenses are increasing by 20%, then the revenues would also be increasing by around 20% or greater than 20%. Why it is only increasing by 7%? Now the figures will not say this to you. In the exam, the pre-seen material is there. From tomorrow we will have the entire 27-30 pages are written. Are we getting any clue for this from the pre-seen? Is there anywhere written in the paragraph anywhere that why this happened? Maybe the company introduced a new product. For this, that they did marketing very well initially. It has not given the benefit of revenue increase that much, but it is going to give you in future. It may be that the company has gone into a new market, a new product. Because of that, initially we need to do huge marketing, but the benefit we have not realized now, we are going to realize in future. Suppose nowhere, nothing clue you are getting in the pre-seen material, nowhere. That means what you will see? Maybe there is an inefficiency in the company. The marketing expenses are increasing in a higher proportion as compared to revenue. The companies would be checking that. Why the increase in the cost, marketing cost, is that such a higher proportion as compared to revenue? In each item, because it's not that I need to answer in the exam after 3-minute analysis. In the pre-seen material tomorrow, when it will be released, the entire income statement and everything will be given to you. They will be there for you till exam date 50-52 days. By that time, so you should remember all the figures. If you will read the pre-seen material 3-4 times, it's not that you are interested in mugging up. Automatically, everything will be mugged up. The ratios, the percentage increase in sales, the percentage increase in gross profit, last year, current year, where everything should be here in the brain. And when the question will be coming on ratio analysis in exam, like it came in February 2020, you should be dancing at that time that I can write a very fantastic answer. You can in the exam open the pre-seen material. You can do the calculation there. But if you are required to do that on the day of exam, that means you are very, very badly prepared. That's something which was given to you 50 days earlier and you don't able to do the calculation and prepare your analysis in advance. The examiner is not saying that you need to show the calculation of gross profit margin. The examiner know that the pre-seen material is there with you for 50 days. So you don't have to show that the gross profit margin last year, gross profit by sale this much, gross profit by, you don't have to show the calculation. The second reason for this is that this is not an exam. They are saying that you are working in the company as a finance manager. So as a finance manager, you know all the figures. So your write-up should not be the answer to a question. Your write-up should be that you know all the things. You are just communicating with the colleagues, with the directors, or anybody who is asking, you are communicating them. The language should be communicational. Till that time, you think that you are writing the answer to the question, it will not be good. When you start feeling that you are working in the company, you are the finance manager, and you are helping the colleagues, the board members, the senior members with your knowledge, then in that case, the answer will be coming along those lines, which is called communication skill. The examiners are saying that in the exam, 5 skills are required. Technical skill, E2, P2, F2 knowledge. Communication skill, communicating to board members, communicating to colleague, communicating to external stakeholders, communicating to somebody who is not a finance person, have never studied finance, that communication. Then we say that technical skill, communication skill, then we can say business skill. If I know return on capital employed, growth, but it cannot apply those theoretical knowledge to the business case study. No point. No point of my whatever is studied in life. I need to apply my knowledge in the business case. Whatever my technical knowledge is there, I need to correlate with the business sense. And I am a finance manager. I need to have leadership quality. I can direct a team. I can manage a team. I can help the persons what should be done, how it should be done. That's leadership quality. And there is a new skill they have added from 2019 syllabus, digital skill. Everything is digital. Financial modeling, artificial intelligence, then cloud computing, whatever you say. That digital competency should be there. How everything can be correlated with digitization. All the skills. I don't have to remember that the SEMA is asking people skill, the communication skill, business skill, technical skill and all that. I don't. Till the time the question is there, I am writing the well answer. I am covering all the skills. But just that the technical write-up says that the student need to have all the 5 skills. So we can say that when the pre-seen material will be there with us tomorrow, you should be doing your calculation or I will be doing for you. That's secondary. But you should be doing all the ratio calculations. You should be analyzing which one is increasing, decreasing, why. You should be reading the pre-seen so that in the class you can raise better questions. It's not that it is not advisable in the next class student is joining the class without reading the material. That means the student is preparing for not giving exam in me. Or for giving the exam but not interested in passing the exam. You can't sit in the next class without reading the pre-seen material 2 times, doing your calculations and all that. I will be sharing with you all the calculation, but you should be doing. Here revenue is given, but maybe company has different types of products or the company has business in different geographical locations. They have given the breakup of the revenue in the case study material. Many times they have given in the past. That 98465 is 4 regions. 98465 is relating to 4 products. Last year, this we need to go into detail which region, which product the revenue has gone up, which has gone down. Why? What information they have given in the pre-seen? Why the revenue has gone down? Why the revenue has gone up? What we need to do to increase the revenue in that region? Why it is going down? Because otherwise, how you will be able to correlate core area A, B, C, D, E? Nothing you can correlate. For the timing, these are figures. Once we do the calculation of the figures, then they say something. The figures are saying something. When in the CNBC or any news channel, you are saying that they are saying the profit has gone up and all that, then some of the persons, those who are knowledgeable, they are saying this has happened. That is analysis. That is financial analysis. It's not that sales has gone up, profit has gone up, this, that. You need to go into deep. And for that, you have been given 25-30 pages of material. With that, you will be able to understand why it is going up, going down, why this is abrupt change, why this is happening. You will be able to make your conclusion. And when you are ready with the conclusion, and the question comes, bang on, 10 out of 10, you can score. There is no fixed answer for that. There is no fixed language. But you need to prepare. Every time you need to be analytical person. Raising the question, why, when, how, what, I can. That type of thing, your reading should be there. Whenever you are reading something, like suppose Sahil was saying that, do we need to calculate WACC? Calculation of WACC is a simple task. You remember the formula, cost of equity, cost of debt, weight of equity, you multiplied, added, get the answer. But in the practical life, is anybody going to give you cost of debt this, weight is this, do the calculation. The practical life is not you need to do 2 into 3. How the 2 will come? How the 3 will come? Whether the calculation of 2 is correct, adequate, proper, whether the calculation of 3 is proper, that you need to do. The junior will be doing the calculation of weighted average cost of capital and NPV calculation and all that. That's not your job. You are the finance manager. There is a finance officer in the company who are working under you, under the finance manager, 3-4 persons. They will do the NPV WACC calculation. But when they are doing the calculation, are they correct? Are they use the correct data? Are they doing the correct analysis? That's your job. Communicating with the board members in a proper direction, that's your job. So calculation is not an important thing in life. The understanding the calculation is more important. So I am not going into further detail, because for analyzing into deep, along with the calculation, we need to have a write-up, which we can say that this is the reason, this has gone up, gone down. That may be the case, maybe something not written in the precinct, but these are the possible situations which has led to this ratio going up, going down. And then whatever will be given in the exam, you will be able to answer properly. If I will correlate this, not reading this, if I will correlate the income statement with the company's balance sheet also, the same company's income statement and the same company's balance sheet also. The balance sheet of last year, fixed assets, property, plant and equipment, 24041 to 25575. What can be the changes from 24041 to 25575? I am not asking the amount of change or percentage. I am asking the reasons for change for 24041 to 25575. Why the property, plant and equipment from last year to current year had changed from 24041 to 25575. You can say your company has purchased more property, plant and equipment. That's expansion. Anything, any other reason? Any other reason? The same thing, expansion, acquisition, we acquired some other organization. So property, we purchased the assets, depreciation, method change, why you are saying depreciation? Because if there is no expansion, then also depreciation will be there. So from 24041, depreciation will be deducted. Definitely must have been deducted. The values would be lower than 24041, but it is higher because of purchases. Can the property, plant and equipment is higher because of revaluation? Can the increase in property, plant and equipment may be increase because of revaluation? Is it possible? If we say this is possible, extra money is spent on equipment upkeep or change in accounting strategy. Why, Sahil, you are saying this? If there is extra money spent on upkeep or this, this is not an asset that will be going to PL account. Why there is increase in asset because of whatever you are saying, Sahil? If the money spent on upkeep or change in accounting strategies, then so it will be going to PL account. Now, why the asset value will increase because of that? You are talking about a revenue expenditure. We are talking about a capital expenditure. Increase in the asset value. I was saying that whether there is any revaluation, somebody says yes. But whether the revaluation will not come in the liability under equity. If there is a revaluation, whether the revaluation reserve will not be there in the equity. If the company will revalue the assets, increase the value of assets. In the asset side, asset value go up. In the liability side, the revaluation reserve will be there. If there is an increase in the capacity, which Achal said, expansion, acquisition, that is increase in capacity. But the upkeep, maintenance is not increase in the asset. I am saying that if there is a revaluation, if we want to say that the asset may have revalued, Don't we think that in the liability side, there should be revaluation reserve also? If in the liability side, there is no revaluation reserve, can we say that the increase in the asset is because of revaluation? If in the liability side, there is no revaluation reserve, can we say that the increase in the asset is because of revaluation? Anybody? I am saying that if the asset are revalued, which I was saying earlier when Sahil said, then you all, two or three persons said that, sir, you are correct. It may be revaluation. Because of revaluation, the asset value goes up. But if the revaluation is done, then the revaluation reserve is also recorded in the liability also. But there is no revaluation reserve in the liability. So can we say that the increase in the value of asset is because of revaluation? Or we can't say that. Can we say that increase in the value of asset is because of revaluation, or we can't say that? No, not a question of gradual process. If the revaluation will be there, then the because of revaluation, suppose this is a computer. The value is 50, I want to revalue to 60,000. So 10,000, the computer value will increase. In the asset side, asset value goes up. So in the liability side, something should go up. Then only the balance sheet will tally. So in the liability side, we have to record revaluation reserve. But in the liability side, there is no revaluation. So how can we say that the increase in the asset is because of revaluation? How can we say? If there is revaluation, then the revaluation reserve will definitely be there in the liability side. But since there is no revaluation reserve, so we can't say that there is a revaluation because of that reason the asset value has gone up. That is what I am saying. So I was saying earlier that we can say increase in the asset because of revaluation also. But I can't say. Because in the liability side, there is no revaluation reserve. So if the revaluation is not there, revaluation reserve is not there, that means there is no revaluation done. So the increase in the asset value may be more assets purchased. Maybe there is acquisition of another company. Obviously depreciation also. But there is no revaluation. It can be expansion, it can be acquisition, it can be depreciation, but there is no expansion. What is this intangible asset? What is this intangible asset? What is this intangible asset? Goodwill. Cannot be including patent, trademark, copyrights, brand, license, technical know-how. Or only goodwill. Right of use is not an intangible asset. Right of use is property, plant and equipment only. If you are taking an asset on lease, land, building, plant, machinery, and you have the right to use the asset, then it is a part of property, plant and equipment, not intangible. Intangible is goodwill, patent, trademark, copyrights, technical know-how, license, all these things. The intangible asset is going down. Why? The intangible asset is going down. Why? 2912 to 2887. Why? Impairment, or first of all, we should say amortization. For tangible assets, the depreciation is called a depreciation. But for intangible assets, the depreciation is called amortization. From 2912 to 2887, the major reason is amortization, which is depreciation. Other than that, there may be impairment. that is the value in the books are greater than what the value they command. So the company has done the impairment. Now we cannot check that whether impairment was done or not, because impairment will not be shown in the liability side. That is already adjusted from retained earnings. The depreciation, amortization, impairment are deducted from retained earnings. So we can't say that impairment is done or not. But the intangible asset can be impairment, amortization, maybe further acquisitions also, anything. Because the change is not only down, it may be up, down, both. The trade receivable balance has slightly gone up. The bank balance has slightly gone up. You can see that not a major change, because the sales of the... Anything can be sold off. Anything. Other than goodwill, anything can be sold off, because for selling the goodwill, you need to sell the entire business. All assets other than goodwill are identifiable intangible assets. But the goodwill is an unidentifiable intangible asset. So you can't sell the goodwill. You have to sell the entire business. But patent, trademark, copyright, technical know-how, license, you can sell. So maybe you have sold the asset, intangible asset, sold off. It may be. So I was saying that the trade receivable bank balance slightly gone up. The sales of the company has gone up. Gross profit, operating profit, all has gone up. So slightly the receivable and bank balance gone up. It's not a problem when they are slightly going up. In the liability side, share capital is same. Share premium has gone. Share capital, share premium. Separate figure not given. They are same. There is no further issue of shares. Foreign currency reserve. What is that? We are saying that maybe we are in the export, import of goods or services. And when we are making payment or receiving payment from the customers, the day when the sale or purchase is done, and the day when we are receiving the payment or making the payment, the foreign exchange rate changes. Because of the change in the foreign exchange rate, there is a loss or gain to the organization. But the foreign exchange reserve was last year 1963 and current year it is only 286. That means there is a huge loss in respect of foreign exchange transactions. In respect of foreign exchange transactions, there is a huge loss to the company. It is given here also. 1677 is loss from in foreign exchange. So from 1963, 1677 gone, 286 is left. The foreign exchange loss, why it is arising? Why in the foreign exchange so much loss the organization is suffering? That the reserve is totally wiped out approximately. It was last year 1667, now it is only 1963, now it is only. I will say that can we say we are not managing the foreign exchange matter properly? Because even though the rate is going down and all that, but the finance manager job or senior finance manager job is to hedging. Hedging means what? If I have dollar receivable after 3 months and I know that the dollar value will be going down, why not I am entering into some forward contract or anything? So that even though the rate will go down, I will not suffer loss. Either the hedging is not effectively done or the hedging is not done at all. Something must be there. Some problems are there with the company. They are not doing the management of foreign exchange properly. Because so much loss in the foreign exchange is not as visible. One reason. The other reason can be, suppose the company has a foreign subsidiary. Suppose we have the foreign subsidiary. Now the foreign, suppose Saraf Academy has a subsidiary in US. That subsidiary is there for last 10 years. So whatever the assets and liabilities of the subsidiary, they are in dollar. Last year they were there, current year they are there. Last year dollar value was say 80 and the current year dollar value is 70. So when I am converting the assets value at the rate of 80, they will be very high. And in the current year, when I am converting at the rate of 70, they are getting lower. So I am suffering losses. Is this actually a loss? The assets were there last year. They are still there. I am not selling the asset. It's just because the dollar value has gone down. Because of that, I am suffering foreign exchange loss. If that is the case, then it is not a problem. Translation. Yes. That is, if we have a foreign subsidiary, foreign branch or anything, and because of translation of foreign assets and liabilities, there is a loss, then it is not actual loss. It's a notional loss. The assets are still there. They were there. But just because of change in the exchange rate, there is a loss. I don't know what is the reason. I am to just hypothecating what can be the reason. I will not be able to discuss in the exam properly if I don't know what are the reasons which are possible. Somebody will say that foreign exchange loss is there, company is not managing the foreign exchange properly, hedging is not done properly. Somebody will say that it is because of foreign subsidiary branch. Both are correct. Both will get marks, but both are writing differently. Revaluation loss is a notional loss. But revaluation loss, the accounting body does not consider as a notional loss. Revaluation loss, the accounting body consider as a realized loss. If the revaluation gain is there, then the accounting body says that it is, notional gain. It's not a realized gain. But when the revaluation loss is there, the accounting body does not consider it as a notional loss. They consider it as an actual loss. Because accounts is conservative approach. Losses would be recognized, gains would not be recognized, like that. So the accounting body says that revaluation loss is not a notional loss. It is an actual loss. So I will say that relating to foreign currency reserve going down, there are two views. I don't know what is the reason. Retained earning is coming from the profit only. Borrowings, the interest has gone down because borrowings is 1900 to 1000. Half the borrowings. So half the interest. Trade payables and taxes slightly gone up because the profit and all that has gone up. So they are in the same line. It's just that getting a feeling about the figures. Not just something is going up 5%, 2%, 10%. You will say that it is enough. Why? Why it is going down? Why it is going up? What can be the valid reasons? That we need to exaggerate. That we need to prepare in advance. And since the case study is given to us 30 pages, we will correlate that with which factor, with which paragraph, with which detail that is saying that this has happened in the financial statement. If something is not written in the precinct, many things not written, then we will speculate. This can be the reason. This may be, so that if anything comes, we will be able to write a good answer. That is called management accounting technique, financial analysis technique. It's not the PL account balance sheet preparation. Doing a critical analysis on the figures. And then when the pre-seen information are given on the basis of that financial analysis, supporting your calculation that why this has happened. That is called financial statement analysis. We do that in the class 3-4 times. But still in the last class, most of the students say, sir, can we do the ratio analysis again? Because it's not simple. It's difficult. It's a high core accounting. It's not that PL account balance sheet preparation. Every type of knowledge in accounting is required for doing financial analysis. I have seen in my life for 30 years, even a fantastic student also face problem in doing the ratio analysis. It's not that percentage calculation. It's more detailed than that. So a proper study is required relating to that. It's something which we can prepare in advance. In exam, we can score very good marks, but it's not free. A proper evaluation needs to be done. Similarly, I have given one more financial statement. Just for the sake of, you can do giving a warm-up, understanding the figures are there. Then the balance sheet of that company is also there. Just that, with the figures, what are the feelings coming? Why the financials are good, bad? Why the ratios are improving, deproving? Whatever is the reasons, we can analyze, critically analyze, which is an important part in your management case study exam. Obviously, it will be based on the figure which will be there in the pre-seen material, not these figures. But then the figures need to be analyzed properly so that you are ready for the exam for that type of question. And many times they have asked the ratio-based questions in exam. We can see that when I will be getting the pre-seen in tomorrow, I will share with all of you, read the pre-seen material two times at least. Do some calculations of ratios. If not a problem, at least read two times. Make a target of 10-12 days how you are going to cover core area A, B, C, D. Do the videos which has been given. And then after the next class, I will be starting with the homework. Let we have the pre-seen. I will be discussing core area A, B, C, D one by one. Application of the pre-seen and the technical knowledge combining together. And then we will be doing the questions from the next class. But presently we don't have the pre-seen. So you are getting that 10 days further to study. That in 10 days, cover up your basic knowledge. Some basic knowledge mainly about F2 and something P2. E2 you can manage automatically. Not the technical study required for E2. Okay. So meeting with all of you as per the schedule, as I said, on Saturday, not this Saturday, next Saturday at 2 o'clock. In that class, I will be taking 2-3 times break, 15-20 minutes each. Suppose we start 2 to 4, 20 minutes break. Then again for 2 hours, 20 minutes break. Then again 1 hour, 2 hour like that. So we will be doing the class with breaks. Suppose I have to leave now because already we are exhausted. If we take a break of 15-20 minutes, we can manage. And we will be able to discuss at length. So that I want in the classes so that we can discuss at length in the classes. Okay. Leaving for today. Thank you to all of you. Please follow my instructions, whatever I said to all of you. Take care. All the very best for your case study exam to all of you. Thank you.